Hello and welcome to Showcase. Today, Bob Dylan and Palestinian art. One of America's greatest songwriters / digital artists turns 80. And Salomon Mansour explains what it means to be an artist under occupation. Singer, songwriter, poet, visual artist. Bob Dylan came to be known for wearing many hats in his long career. And at the age of 80, Dylan is still going strong. Here's Sena Arslan with more.
Robert Allen Zimmerman was a boy from Minnesota before he moved to New York City in 1961 and changed his name to Bob Dylan. In a career that spanned 60 years, the staff at Rolling Stone magazine voted him America's greatest songwriter. Dylan has written more than 500 songs and sold more than 125 million albums around the world. The 1960s civil rights and anti-war movements embraced his songs as anthems. His impact on American culture is so profound that he's earned both a Pulitzer Prize and a Nobel as a poet. A voice of a generation, Dylan now is focused on visual arts and archival recording. He's preparing for his first show in the United States called Bob Dylan Retrospectum, that'll take place later this year in Miami. And a new Bob Dylan Center will exhibit his personal archive in Tulsa, Oklahoma in 2022. I used to care. All this coming from someone who once said he was irritated when the media portrayed him as a 60s artist. He wanted to be an artist of all time.
Spencer Lay now joins me, author of Bob Dylan, Outlaw Blues. Hi there, it's good to have you with us today. So tell us, what do you think his biggest legacy for the world of music is?
I think it's just an extraordinary catalogue of songs in all types of different media. I think he's done extremely well. And the songs that he wrote in the 1960s have certainly endured and become standards like Blowing in the Wind, Times They Are Changing.
Okay, let me ask this. Obama said in 2012 that there is not a bigger giant in the history of American music. Would you agree?
Well, you can't really compare things like that. I mean, you can't compare him, say, to Louis Armstrong or what have you, or to the classical composers. But I mean, I would think he is the voice of the generation of the 1960s, and he has continued that through to the present time. But I think he grew up at a very interesting time when the floodgates really opened and the Beatles were happening, the Beach Boys were happening. There were so many great composers around. And I think they all fed off each other.
Spencer, honestly, Barack Obama's is the popular opinion. So, but then some people, of course, believe Bob Dylan is overrated. So do you think his iconic status today in the American history of music is well-deserved?
I think the status he's received is very well-deserved. I think it is a remarkable catalogue of music. He's been going for such a long time, and no other composer has got a body of work like this. So many songs, and so many songs that are known to so many people. And as well as writing his famous protest songs of the 60s, like Blowing in the Wind and Times They Are Changing, he was also able to write straight down the line commercial love songs if he wanted to. I'll Be Your Baby Tonight is an example of that. It was a big hit for Robert Palmer in the UK, and Make You Feel My Love, which was a huge hit for Adele. So he can write in all sorts of media, I think.
Okay, do you think his biggest strength is his writing?
His writing and his performing. I mean, I was lucky enough to see Bob Dylan in 1965 and 1966, and I thought he was extraordinary on both occasions. 1966 was amazing because this was the famous Judas tour where someone shouted out Judas to him in Manchester. He was performing with a rock band who became the band, and a lot of the audience who were real folk music fans didn't like it at all. And I thought it was interesting when I came to do my book, I thought, how many performers have deliberately alienated an audience before because they knew what they wanted to do and they had that artistic integrity. So I went right back to classical composers like Berlioz and to Stravinsky and saw how Dylan was in line with that. He was someone who had his own vision and did what he wanted to do. And really, nobody could tell him what to do. And that is part of the charm of Bob Dylan, part of the excitement about him. Even now, his recent album, Rough and Rowdy Ways, is like no other album that he has made or that anybody else has made for that point of fact.
Okay, what is the importance of that album for you?
The recent one, I think it covers so many grounds. I was particularly interested in this album because he has now found a way to use his limited singing voice. He can't really sing very well now, but he's developed a style that involves sort of part narration, part singing the songs, and I think it works really well, and it gives us a lot of hope for the future as to what he's going to do on future albums. And the fact that he put out, well, his record company put out in the States Murder Most Foul as a single, and that was his first number one hit in the States since his career. Like a Rolling Stone wasn't a number one single. So it is quite extraordinary that someone at the age of 79 was getting the number one single in America. People are still listening to Bob Dylan because the songs are just so great. And growing the explosion of sound in the 60s, and no other generation has been like that.
Now, Spencer, you praised Bob Dylan's live performance, but people who think that he is overrated say that his voice is not just good enough to make him a musical legend. For example, in the Enemy blog, Mark Beaumont says, Bob Dylan's voice is like a ferret being skinned alive with a potato peeler. Do you understand those kind of concerns?
I understand it. In the 1960s, when he came along, we couldn't believe that he had got a recording contract with a voice like that. It was so different. It wasn't conventional at all. But if you go back to Woody Guthrie, who was his mentor from the 1940s, at that time, he was actually sounding very like Woody Guthrie. These are very rough-hewn voices. And the songs really came out of that. So the voice fitted the songs perfectly. Admittedly, he was never going to be Pavarotti or anyone like that. And he did miss notes in it. But it didn't actually matter. There are people who are real trained musicians who much prefer to hear Dylan's songs sung by somebody else. And it was interesting that a few years ago, when he wrote a great song called Mississippi, he gave it to Sheryl Crow before he recorded it himself, probably thinking that because his voice was limited, Sheryl Crow was going to do a much better job on it. And technically and musically, she does do a better job on it. But there's still the magic of hearing Dylan's voice. And I don't care whether he misses the notes or not. It's him. It's authentic. It's real.
Okay, when we started talking, you mentioned the significant role Bob Dylan played in the 60s. Do you think he is still as relevant?
Not especially, because I think I'll have seen most of them before. I mean, they've been exhibited in UK galleries for years, because any picture that he's done, he's made about 300 prints of it, and they've been sold signed for £2,000 each. So I've seen a lot of them in Liverpool. So I don't, there will be some new ones, I'm sure, in the exhibition, but I'm sure we'll have seen a lot of them before. But they're interesting pictures of train tracks and the like. My view of art is, would this look good in my living room? And I would say yes to most of them. I think they're very, very pleasant work.
Okay, probably out of his will to stay relevant, as relevant as he was in the 60s, he's coming up with an exhibition now. Are you excited for it?
Not especially, because I think I'll have seen most of them before. I mean, they've been exhibited in UK galleries for years, because any picture that he's done, he's made about 300 prints of it, and they've been sold signed for £2,000 each. So I've seen a lot of them in Liverpool. So I don't, there will be some new ones, I'm sure, in the exhibition, but I'm sure we'll have seen a lot of them before. But they're interesting pictures of train tracks and the like. My view of art is, would this look good in my living room? And I would say yes to most of them. I think they're very, very pleasant work.
Okay, thanks so much for being here. Well, Zeynep Gökçe has more about that exhibit in Miami that marks Dylan's first ever art show in America.
Bob Dylan is getting an exhibition in Miami with the singer/artist showing off his largest collection of artworks later this year. The exhibition is an update to Retro Spectrum, a show that first opened in Shanghai and spans 6 decades of Dylan's art. But the show in Florida will include never-before-seen pieces and his latest painting series called American Pastoral. Ever since Dylan kicked off his never-ending tour in 1988, he's been on the road, and much of his work reflects his impressions of those constant travels, especially the ones in the United States. In 1994, he released a book of sketches depicting women, hotel scenes, and cityscapes. It was later turned into an exhibition, and one of its stops was New York in 2011.
Most of these sketches were done over 15 years ago. They were put together in a book at one point as black and white sketches. And it was a book that was published by Random House called Drawn Blank Series. In 2007, Bob Dylan was approached by a museum in Germany with the concept of taking those very same sketches and now enlarging them, because the sketches were rather small, and adding color to them.
From that point on, there was a growing appreciation for Dylan's art. In 2016, the UK's Halcyon Gallery approached him to do more paintings of America as part of the exhibit called The Beaten Path. He agreed and told Vanity Fair at the time, "The common theme of these works have something to do with the American landscape, how you see it while crisscrossing the land and seeing it for what it's worth, staying out of the mainstream and traveling the back roads, freeborn style." But the last time he was able to do that was in 2019, because after the coronavirus pandemic broke out, Dylan's tours were cancelled. By the time his Retro Spectrum exhibition in Miami comes out, maybe he'll be back on the road.
Suleiman Mansour says in 1981, an Israeli officer tried to convince him not to make political art and draw flowers instead. Since then, Mansour has become one of the most prominent contemporary artists in Palestine. His most popular work is considered the Camel of Hardships, which helped make the dispute with Al-Aqsa Mosque a symbol of Palestinian identity. And when in the 1980s Israel banned Palestinians from using the colors of their flag, Mansour joined a boycott against Israeli art supplies. Instead, he says he chose to only use natural materials from his homeland. Well, Suleiman Mansour joins me now from occupied East Jerusalem. Hi there, it's good to have you with us today. So Suleiman, tell us, what does it mean to be a Palestinian artist for you today?
I think it has two sides. One side is good, you know, because where we live is full of contradictions and full of problems, and all this atmosphere is good for the artist to get ideas and to do what I need to give him more ideas about life and about art. On the other hand, it's really difficult because to be an artist under occupation with no support, no art market, not even infrastructure for making art, it's very hard. But we are managing, and I think The most important thing is that we get a lot of ideas from the occupation.
Okay, today you're one of the most renowned Palestinian artists, and you're often referred to as the artist of the Intifada. Do you feel a burden on your shoulders, you know, being considered a hero, really?
Yes, I don't like to have that feeling, you know, because it gives you a feeling that you have to all the time it's a challenge to be better and better. And for an artist who likes, you know, kind of freedom, and even for an old man like me, it's very tiring, you know. I don't like that name, and I don't like that feeling also. I'm proud of it, of course, but I don't like it so much.
And how do you deal with being that person, you know, being considered to be that person? For example, do you consider yourself to be a political artist?
I think most of my paintings deal with the Palestinian problem. So, but it's actually not a decision that I have to make, you know, from the beginning to say that I want to be a political artist. I mean, the life we live here, and it forces you to deal with these problems, and suddenly, little by little, you find yourself that you are a political artist. It's not a decision that I make.
Okay, Suleiman, do you sometimes perhaps feel the pressure to paint political landscapes only? I mean, as Suleiman Mansour, you know, the renowned political Palestinian artist from occupied East Jerusalem, would you feel free to just paint anything, you know, just flowers, just like the Israeli officer told you, or, you know, anything just beautiful, just for the sake of it, just for the sake of art?
I think a lot of my paintings are about beauty, even if they have a kind of political atmosphere in them. But you know, like the painting you have behind you of the orange grove and the woman. If you don't know the name of the painting, then you look at it as a beautiful painting. I keep in mind, and I think it's a way of getting a better feedback as a political artist, to make something beautiful. It's the best way to get into the eyes, the minds, the taste of people, and it becomes easier to give your message and make it reach to the people.
Okay, what is the message you're trying to give with your art?
Look, Palestinians, they live in, they don't have a state. Many people in the world, they don't even recognize their existence. They are forbidden even until now in Jerusalem and in other places to use the colors of the Palestinian flag. I think art, it gives the people a kind of home. It gives them a kind of homeland. It gives them a kind of pride, a kind of hope for the future.
And do you think that art can play a big role in the fight for freedom in Palestine today?
I'm sure. In the beginning, I didn't think that art has such a big power, you know. But, you know, little by little, I noticed that if I make a painting, a poster, and so on, it makes people move. It makes them happy in a way. It makes them strong in a way. It gives them a kind of pride and strength. And I think this is the power of art. It gets people into a kind of imaginative beauty that is helpful for their psychology, for their hope and so on.
Mm-hmm. And perhaps give them a deeper perspective on the pressing issues of today, I guess. Okay, Suleyman Mansur, I appreciate your time. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you. Thank you. Welcome.
Actor David Oyelowo has made his directorial debut. The promotion was unexpected, but some of the best filmmakers in the business showed him a thing or two.
The Waterman is real. Legend has it that he's still living up by the lake.
Gunnar is looking for the Waterman. It's a mythical being, but the boy believes it could cure his mother's leukemia. David Oyelowo plays Gunnar's father, Amos.
What we're used to.
Yeah, real different.
The family drama took a hit when its director dropped out, but Oyelowo stepped up. This was his first time in the role, and Oyelowo needed backup, so he reached out to a few directors, including his former boss on the 2014 film, Selma.
Ava DuVernay said to me, make sure that you know the theme of your movie, and that theme works its way into every character, every scene, and the totality of the film. She said that a mistake that she feels she made earlier on in her career is that she would direct a romantic scene like it was a love story, or she would direct an action scene like it was an action movie. But you know, that is what leads to a tonally uneven film.
Oyelowo also worked with director Will Gluck, who gave him some tough love.
He said, the director of photography, all they care about is their shot. The costume, all they care about is how good the costumes look in the shot. The actors, all they care about is their individual performance. You are the only one who has an eye on the entire movie. So it's not that they don't care about your movie, they only care about their portion of your movie. You're the only one who cares about the totality of it. So do not move on until you feel like you've captured what you need.
And Oyelowo still needed more advice. After all, the movie's executive producer is Oprah, so tons of pressure there. That's when Oyelowo got the biggest lift of all, and it came from his fellow actor-turned-directors.
So Nate Parker is, a big person in my life. He's one of my best friends in the world, and so to talk to him about how he was able to direct Birth of a Nation while being in it. Joel Edgerton is another very good friend who has directed The Gift and Boy Erased, and he gave me great advice. And then, you know, the big daddy of them all, in my view, is Mel Gibson. I just do not know how you direct and star in Braveheart. That's just crazy to me. But thankfully, these are all people in my life who I'm able to have conversations with.
And it seems like those directing lessons paid off. The Waterman has received mixed but generally positive reviews. Critics say Oyelowo has made a splash with a movie that's like a thoughtful middle-grade novel that's come to life.
That's it on this episode of Showcase. Our YouTube channel, Instagram and Twitter accounts have more from the world of culture and the arts. I'm Elif Bereketli. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.